I'm sure you can hear me at the back, right? Can you hear me at the back?
Yes.
Okay, good. Well, let me start by saying that I'm very delighted to be sharing fellowship with you this morning. I have looked forward to the opportunity of sharing fellowship with you exclusively like this. I'm grateful to Pastor Oke, who has facilitated this time around for me to be here. And I'm also grateful to you guys for having me. To acknowledge with deep appreciation the contribution of the youth ministry to our church. And I want to say a very big thank you to all of you. And in any case, the youth ministry remains the heartbeat of the church, and I hope you guys know that.
Yes.
You are the powerhouse of the church. Do you know that? Yeah, you're not responding to me.
Yes.
I say you are the powerhouse of the church.
Yes.
If you believe me, say yes, we are.
Yes, we are.
Oh, great. You are indeed the powerhouse of the church, and by the grace of God, as we go into the future, I really want to see you live it out even more. And I pray that the Lord will continue to create more opportunities and we'll all work together on fresh initiatives that will give opportunities for expression of both ministry and all that the Lord has endowed you with. So let us pray. Father, we want to thank you for this time. We want to magnify your name. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being able to come before your presence. And Lord, as we share from your word today, I just pray, Father, that you give us insight into your word. And I pray, Lord, that you help us to understand. And I pray, Lord, that your word will indeed make a difference in our lives. And help us, Lord, to be able to connect with the life-changing wisdom of your word.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Amen.
To you be all the glory.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we are praying.
Amen.
If you have your Bible here, I want you to please just turn with me quickly to Isaiah. And I'll be reading two passages from that book of the Bible. And our theme for the month is intimacy with God, and our topic today is the faithful lover. The faithful what? The faithful lover. I want us to turn to Isaiah chapter 1, and I'll read the first passage. I'll read is chapter 1, I'll read verses 1 to 3, and then I will cross quickly to chapter 3, and I'll read verses 1 to 5. Perhaps someone else should read chapter 3, verses 1 to 5 for me. So if you're going to read, just get ready. But let me read the very first passage. It says, "The word of the Lord that came to Uzziah, the son of Beeri, during the reign of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and during the reign of Jeroboam, son of Jehoash, king of Israel." Verse 2. "When the Lord began to speak to Uzziah, the Lord said to him, 'Go, take to yourself an adulterous wife and children of unfaithfulness, because the land is guilty of the various adultery in departing from the Lord.' So he married Gomer, daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son." So someone else should read chapter 3, verses 1 to 5.
"Lord said to me, 'Go show your love to your wife again, though she is loved by another man with an adulteress. Love her as the Lord loved the Israelites, though they turned to other gods and loved the sacred raising kings. For I bought half of the shekels of silver, and about a woman and a letter of value. And I told her, you have to live with me many days. You must not be a prostitute or be intimate with any man, and I will behave the same way toward you. For the Israelites will live many days without king or prince, without sacrifice or sacred stones, without effort or household gods. Afterward, the Israelites will return and seek the Lord their God and David their king. They will come trembling to the Lord and his blessing in the last days.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Okay.
Now,
since we came up with this theme, intimacy with God, and perhaps a little earlier, I have been interacting with the team and thinking through. And some of the things that I've been thinking about are, what are the things that stop us from building intimacy with God? Why don't we desire and seek intimacy with God? Or even when we do desire and seek, what are those things that stand between us? And I've come up with a number of things, and I keep thinking through them, and I keep looking at the Bible. But one of them that I've been thinking through lately is perhaps many of us don't have sufficient knowledge of the God that we serve. Perhaps many of us have not really interacted sufficiently with God to be able to understand and know him. And typically, when you don't know someone very well, the desire to be intimate sometimes may not be there. And sometimes the more you know someone, the more you want to get closer to the person, particularly if you like what you're seeing or if you like the experience of drawing close to that person. And my mind went to the story of Hosea. I thought maybe that's one story I should share with you this morning. It's one story that I used to struggle with when I first came across it when I was in secondary school. And I think it was one of the books of the Bible that we had to read as part of our Bible knowledge syllabus. And my struggle then was, why will God ask someone to go and marry an immoral lady? I mean, you look at the whole prophet, and then, you know, why will God tell him to go and marry a prostitute? Okay. Now, let me ask a question. How many of you here will do it? Eh? How many of you will do it? Let me see the guys. How many of you guys will do it? No hands up. Even when God says it. So those were my struggles. But you see, as I look back at that story and as I engage with this account of scripture, it becomes a lot clearer to me that even against the background and the context of the story, the level of apostasy that Israel, the people of Israel, were in at that time, and why it was important for God to make a very clear statement. The Lord needed Hosea's marriage to be able to tell a story as well as convey his message to the people. In essence, he was meant to experience the message that he was to convey. But for me, the real message that hits me
is the fact that that was my state before the Lord redeemed me. I was lost in sin before the Lord redeemed me. And perhaps it's the same with many of you. And perhaps it's still the same position with those that are yet to give their lives to Christ. That we were all as filthy as Goma when Hosea had to pick her up and marry her. That we're all lost in sin and in prostitution and in immorality, following other gods and hobnobbing with other idols. That was my state before Christ came to make a difference in my life. And as I look at that story now, it makes even greater meaning and sense to me. That, and the Bible, the word in Romans makes greater meaning to me. That God demonstrated his love to us whilst we're what? Yet what? Whilst we're yet sinners. Romans 5:8, whilst we were yet sinners, he demonstrated his love for us. So I was like, woman. And Hosea remains a dim example of God. And he begins to give me a glimpse of God's love for me. And I'm able to connect better to this story. And then the story then progresses. I will skip the marriage metaphor because you all can see it, you know, when you talk about God's relationship with us and the use of marriage to illustrate that relationship. But just to point out that just like a husband goes through pain in marriage when the wife is unfaithful and vice versa, God goes through a lot of pain each time we fail him, we disappoint him, we refuse to be intimate with him, we refuse or we ignore him. A few days ago, as I was going through my devotion, one of the things that struck me was the fact that that I could ignore God. You know, and when God is trying to get my attention, and I'm either resisting or I am not giving the right kind of attention, what I am doing in essence is what? Ignoring God. Are you following what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
That I could be ignoring God. So God goes through pain, just like a lover who has given up, who has given so much and has put in so much into the relationship. Yet what he gets in return is unfaithfulness. And that was the predicament of Hosea in his relationship with his wife. After he's shown her so much love, she leaves him, she goes back to the temple of Baal to go into idolatry, and then in the course of idolatry she also goes into a lot of immorality. And we're told in Hosea 3:1, the Lord said to me, go show your love to your wife again, though she is loved by another and in an adulteress and is an adulteress. Love her as the Lord loves Israelite. Though they turn to other gods and love the sacred raisin cakes. We see that Gomer left her husband and returned to the life of prostitution. She seemed to have ended up in the slave market in the process. Yet, Hosea goes, he shows her his love, desires her again as his wife, and he redeems her from the slave market. It's amazing to see that even though what he paid to buy her back may not look big to us, but beyond what he paid is the whole act of forgiving her and taking her back. And it only reminds us that love pays the price. And as I look at Goma, I sometimes see myself in Goma, in my relationship with God. How sometimes we drift away from God. God that loves us so much, cares so much about us. Even after we have given our lives to Christ, even after we have committed ourselves to Him, we drift away. And like Goma, we go back to idolatry. And I'm sure if you look at the life of Goma, you probably will see glimpses of yourself in the life of, in the story of Goma. And that was the reality of Goma's life. Then Hosea goes and, in response to God's command, brings her back. And it's interesting to see that love is indeed a conscious choice that we have to make. God called the prophet to pursue a radical kind of love for his wife. A love that is based on a deliberate and conscious choice to be committed to her for her benefit, regardless of her response to that gift. That was how God was committed to Israel. And as the scene in the family of Hosea was running, the same thing was working between God and Israel. Because Israel was drifting so much away from God. And they were working so closely to when the northern kingdom was going to fall and they were going to be taken into captivity in Assyria. Yet the Lord was telling them through Hosea that He loves them. And though they have taken to idolatry and following other gods like Baal, He was still willing to have them back. And then Hosea goes after Goma. Just like God will go after Israel. But more importantly, just like God will go after you and I today. And the real thing for us to think through is, what is the state of our intimacy with God? Are we drawing close to God? Are we desirous of building an intimate relationship with God? Or have we drifted away? Have we moved away from God? Have we gone into idolatry like Israel? Have we gone into idolatry and drifted into immorality like Goma? A few days ago, as I was studying my Bible, one thing that hit me, you know, when you talk about idols, you know, sometimes you start thinking of some big things. But I'm realizing that there are little things that can become idols in our lives. And perhaps it's good to begin to do a careful introspection at this time to think, so what are those things that are idols in my life that are beginning to compete with God in my life? When God needs my attention, what are those things that stand between me and giving God the time that He needs? Those are idols. And we need to watch it. What are those things that we have become so addicted to that we cannot live without? And we cannot put aside for even a while so that we can give God the desired attention. For those of you who are married or who are engaged, just imagine for a moment that you can't get the attention of your husband, or you cannot get the attention of your boyfriend. Now, how would you feel? There's something there that, look, the guy is just, he's wrapped into. What begins to happen? You begin to feel bad, right? Won't you feel bad? You feel jealous. And do you guys know that God is a jealous God? Eh? So what are those things that are beginning to constitute themselves into idols in our lives? We need to watch it. Because we may just be drifting into idolatry. And you know, there was something I discovered too recently that really shocked me. As I was just thinking through all this intimacy and walking through, is the fact that I can be an idol to myself. Have you ever thought of that? That you can be an idol to yourself? Do you know that? I discovered it. That I can be an idol. And now I understand better when the Bible says that, look, you and I need to die to self. Because some people love themselves so much. Love themselves so much. Everything is about themselves. That they have become idols to themselves. We need to think through that as well. And these are some of the things that the story of Goma bring to the fore, both for me and I hope for you. The prophet was demonstrating the love of God for his unfaithful people and providing a symbol of the reconciliation that will someday take place. You know, the prophet was giving insight because God desired a reconciliation with his people. So no matter the idols that you may have in your life, no matter those things that compete for your attention with God, those things that make it difficult for you to spend meaningful time to pray or to consolidate on your intimacy with God, those are all idols. The Lord is there and is seeking reconciliation. You and I need to recognize some of those things. And God wants to be reconciled to us so that we can get onto the path of building intimacy again. And that's why I keep saying that, look, intimacy is a very conscious thing. So as we talk of the Father, as we talk of God here as a faithful lover, he also expects that you and I will be faithful lovers, right? Who wants to love and does not want to be loved in return? Is there anyone like that here? Eh? I think in those days there used to be a song by Teddy Pendergrass, you know, that talks about everybody wants to love and be loved, etc. It talks about 50-50 love. Even though I don't quite agree with that. I normally say it's 100-100 love. So you give 100, I give 100. But the reality is, intimacy demands that we are also faithful lovers of God. And that God is watching. He's conscious of anything that would compete for your attention with Him. He's conscious of anything that would compete for your love with Him. He wants 100%. He's not 50%. Because he's giving all. And as I ran down, the question that I have here is, how do we respond to the faithful lover? How do we respond to the faithful lover? And for me, this is getting onto the path of intimacy, building intimacy with God. He says, the same pattern of immoral living can be seen today wherever God's people turn away from true commitment to Him. Sometimes we turn and worship other gods like money, position, idols, anything that takes the place of God in our lives. Anything that takes the place of God in our lives would pass as an idol. We need to recognize them for what they are. We need to ask that the Lord will help us and deliver us from those idols.
Amen.
So they don't control us. They don't compete for attention with God in our lives. We're as guilty of infidelity and idolatry and adultery as the Israelites. What a way to respond and treat a faithful lover. Afterwards, the Israelites will return, and that's what we're told in Hosea. After many days without a king or prince, and without the sacrifice, Israel will return to God and to their Davidic king, the Messiah. Ultimately, if you follow the story, you will see that the Israelites returned. They heeded after several years in captivity in Assyria to God. And the Lord presents to us a unique opportunity today to be reconciled to Him, to review our lives and look at all those things that stand between us and intimacy with Him. All those things that stand between us and becoming faithful lovers of the Lord. The things that stop us from making that conscious decision to love God the way He loves us. You know, I know that for many of you, at your age, you are desirous of building career. Some you want to build your home. And sometimes some of these things can take all of our attention. And they can also become idols for us. But the reality is that, you see, if we make the right choice and we take the conscious decision and we put first things first, the Lord will order those things for us and they will all fall in their places. And the Lord will perfect all that concerns us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
But experience has shown that if we don't make the right choices and we don't balance our priorities properly, the tendency is we may just give attention to those things that we think are most important now. But the reality is that down the line, the things that we have neglected begin to manifest and we have to deal with them. I don't know how many of you are exposed to this concept of the wheel of life, the balance map. You know, there's this concept about the balance map and then the wheel of life. And essentially what it does is that it compartmentalizes life into about 6 different areas. And we're expected to pay attention to each of these areas. And if you have a circle, and you divide the circle into 6, The six areas will be spiritual and ministry. One is health and physical. The other one is financial and career. The fourth one is family. The other one is social and cultural. And then the sixth boss is intellectual. And we are encouraged to pay a balanced attention to all these six areas of our lives. And that represents the wheel of life. Now, for those of you who are familiar with wheels, particularly for bicycles, you know you have spokes in between the wheel, right? Now, anytime you have a damaged spoke in a wheel, what happens to that wheel? Not many of you are familiar with bicycles. Now, when a spoke is faulty in a wheel, the wheel wobbles. You know what it means to wobble? The wheel wobbles. Why? Because one spoke is bad. Ideally, the wheel is supposed to be balanced, so that when the wheel moves, it moves in a balanced, steady fashion. But once one spoke or the other is damaged in the wheel, then the wheel begins to wobble. So we're told that each of these six areas represents the spokes within the wheel of life. So when you neglect one, neglect the other, or you neglect two, then the wheel of your life begins to do what? Wobbles. So it's no longer balanced. So you know, when a wheel wobbles, it will just be going like this. And if you don't make conscious effort to pay a balanced attention to all these six areas, set goals, prayerfully set goals, ask the Lord to lead you in all of these areas, the tendency is to focus on just one area because you think that, oh, this is the most important area now. And it's only a matter of time. The areas that you have neglected will begin to manifest signs of neglect. And then what happens typically is the moment you begin to have a problem in the areas that you have neglected, you then shift attention from that area you've been focusing on to the area you've been neglecting that is manifesting attention. And then the area that you've shifted attention from begins to suffer as well. So the entire model teaches us to be more proactive and to try and give a balanced attention to all these areas. But the reality is that any area that you neglect is only a matter of time. Problems will begin to manifest. So for instance, you take finance and career, which is very typical at certain stage in our lives. And then everything is about career. Everything is about finance. And then you don't set family goals. You don't set spiritual goals. You don't set intellectual goals. It's only a matter of time. Down the line, the gaps will become a lot more manifest. And you see that, oh, what have I done? I'm lagging seriously behind in the intellectual segment of my life. And then you now want to divert every attention there in order to correct the defect. When you begin to do that, what then happens? The career and finance may then begin to suffer. If you neglect spiritual and ministry, it's only a matter of time. You lose contact and connection with God. And that area suffers significantly. and it impacts everything. So the recall is for us to pay a balanced attention to all of these areas. But my greater call to you today is to make a conscious decision to be a faithful lover, to respond to God and show Him the kind of love that He has shown you, to respond to Him as a faithful lover as you seek intimacy with God. And I pray that the Lord will help you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And as you think about Goma, and as I think about Goma, I see myself in Goma. But I'm resolute that I'll respond to God in love. And I'll put behind me anything that stands between God, between me and building intimacy with God. And that is the call that I want you all to make today. That anything that stands between you and building intimacy with God, you will put it behind. And also be a faithful lover, just like the Lord is to you. I want us to bow our heads and pray. I just want you to speak to the Lord. As you look at the life of Goma, I want you to also look at your life and do a very careful introspection. Is Goma a reflection of your life in your relationship with God? Today presents you a very unique opportunity to be fully reconciled with God. And that is what God desires. Reconciliation with Him. He wants to be reconciled. And that was the whole idea for God. When He asked Uzziah to marry Goma, He wanted a clear message to the people of Israel that He seeks after them. He wants to be reconciled. Is anyone here who has not at any time given his or her life to the Lord Jesus Christ? You haven't started on the path of this intimacy at all. You are just at that very first stage of Goma, deep in immorality, but far away from God. But today you want to make a decision to be reconciled to God. You want to respond to God's love for you. You want to make that conscious decision. You want to ask Jesus to come into your life so you can embrace Christ and go into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and be to Him the faithful lover that He has been to you all along. This is your chance. Just signify by raising up your hands. I will pray with you where you are. And the Lord will reach out to you. You want to give your life to Christ. You want Christ to come into your life. You want to be reconciled to God. You've never given your life to Christ. You want to ask Christ to come into your life. This is your chance. I want to give all such persons the opportunity to make a decision for Christ this morning. You want to give your life to Christ. This is your chance. This is the unique opportunity that you have to decide for Christ. The rest of us, I want us to Let's keep examining our lives. What are those things that stand between you and building intimacy with God? Are there things that you have identified that you think are idols that compete for your attention or make it difficult for you to build intimacy with God? And you identify them as idols that they are. You want to ask that the Lord helps you to overcome the influence of those idols, the controlling influence of those idols. If you are here, you have any of those idols or anything you have identified, and you want me to pray for you, just signify by raising up your hands. Just where you are, I'll pray with you. Just signify by raising up your hand. You're raising it up to God and not to man. And I just want you to be honest and sincere with yourself. And as you raise your hands up, just begin to talk to God. Just begin to talk to God. Identify the idol and ask the Lord to take it away. Ask the Lord to help you. You don't want anything to compete with God in your life. Ask the Lord to help you. You want to gain control. Nothing should control you. Father, I want to thank you for your children. I want to thank you for all those that have raised their hands up. You know the idols in their lives. And today, Father, they want to lay it at the altar. Lord Jesus, I pray that, Father, you will deliver them from those idols in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
That, Lord, from now on, no such idols will compete for your love in their lives in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And that, Lord, as they make this conscious decision to be faithful lovers to you just like you have been to them, Eternal Rock of Ages, I pray that the Holy Spirit will grant them all the enablement that they need in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I just pray, Lord, that Father, your Holy Spirit will release grace into their lives. Will release grace into their lives. And will release all that they need and power to live above all these influences in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And as many of your children here this morning as have decided that they want to be faithful lovers of you, they want to begin to build intimacy with you, I pray, Eternal Rock of Ages, that you grant them grace in the name of Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that you help them as they make this conscious decision to love you. I pray, Lord, that you keep them in constant remembrance, that they will take every step on a daily basis to draw closer to you. And to you will all the glory be. Thank you, Father. Take all the glory. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen.
Thank you.